Thank you, everyone, for coming, and also I would like to thank the Diagonal for inviting me to participate in this conference. I know that it's happening a very important political moment for Spain, with all of the demonstration happenings and the strike yesterday. So thank you very much for taking the time to come today. Let me start by speaking about my own experience, because Gonzalo mentioned it briefly. I became one of the first bloggers in the Middle East by accident, by complete accident. I had a friend of mine in 2002 in Iraq. His name is Salam. He was in Baghdad, stuck in the house because he didn't want to do his military service. So he was bored. He didn't have anything to do. So he started what he called three websites. We didn't even know the word blog at the time. One to communicate with me, and one to communicate with his cousin in Emirates. So he jokingly called the website that is to communicate with me, he called it Where is Raed, which is my name, because I never answer his emails. So it was an inside joke. Like, we put things about, you know, as you see here, silly jokes about, you know, what we had for lunch, you know, pictures about me eating, stuffing my hair, hearty burgers, which are this big.
Yeah.
You know, like things from everyday life. And when the time of the invasion approached in 2003, we started getting more traffic from the US and from other countries. And then the blog turned from a joke between two people to a platform where we were reaching out to tens of thousands of readers every day. I mean, I think it's a good story to demonstrate how random the selection of bloggers is. That I turned from you know, someone who's living in Baghdad to an ambassador representing Iraqis overnight, because I had a website and I knew how to speak English. I mean, fast forward to last week, you know, my generation, people who are in their mid-30s now, think of blogs as something revolutionary. I mean, I thought of it as a tool that changed my life. It helped me reach out to hundreds of thousands of people who live around the world. I even met my wife, because she was one of my blog readers. So it's a big thing. Last week I was in a conference in Lebanon, and all of these new revolutionary kids came to the conference. They're all 18 and 19 years old. They're the ones who went to Tahrir Square and to in front of the Ministry of Interior in Tunis, from all around the Arab world. So I'm telling them about Blogger, and they didn't know what Blogger is. I felt so old. There's this new generation that doesn't even know what Blogger is. I want to touch on something very fast before I start talking about the Arab world and the Arab Spring, which is something that both of the other speakers, Maria and Olga, touched on. The difference between new media and old media, traditional media. I think 10 years ago, when I started blogging, there was a clear line, a clear-cut difference between reading my blog, or any blog, and going to CNN or you know, a mainstream media outlet. Now things are more mixed. They're more mixed because of, I think, two main reasons. One of them is that all of the traditional media, all of them, are using new media as well. And in many cases, they are even better than activists at it, because they have more money, they have more time, they have more training to do it. And the other reason is that even the new media outlets have been co-opted by the traditional media. So for a blog or a YouTube or a campaign like Kony 2012, which I'm very critical of, for these things to actually make it and get to millions of people, they have to be covered by the traditional media first. So it took us to square one. You need the TV to tell you about YouTube, and then you go open the YouTube. Because there are billions of YouTubes every day, you don't know which one to choose from. So I mean, that's a good point, I think, that the last decade witnessed this shift, that the lines between new media and old media have become more blurry. I'll talk today, focus a little bit about new media and the Arab Spring. I mean, before I start doing this, I want to mention that for the last decade, I have argued over and over that the United States should not have invaded Iraq, and that Iraqis would have been capable to change or improve their government by themselves. And the mainstream argument in the English-speaking media has always been that Arabs are not capable of defending themselves. Arabs are not capable of planning and implementing their own revolutions. Something that I never believed. I always believed that Arabs and other people can fight their fights, and they can win their revolutions without American bombs falling on their heads. I think the Arab Spring in the last year proves very clearly that Arabs don't need an American tank to liberate them, that they know how to do it themselves, and they do it better. I reach out to my friends in Egypt now who are complaining about the heavy price that is being paid in Egypt or in Syria for these revolutions. I think every death is a disaster. But just to put things in context, the entire casualties that fell in Egypt in a year are less than people who used to be killed in Iraq in a day. The entire casualties that fell in Syria in a year are less than people who used to be killed in Iraq in a week. So I think that the Syrian government is the Syrian government's actions are criminal, and I criticize them a lot. But I just think that we have to always think about how the price of foreign occupations and foreign interventions is a million times heavier. The toll is a million times heavier. When Egyptians do their revolution, they don't burn their museums, and they don't loot their universities, and kill a million people in 5 years, and displace 5 million people like it has in Europe. What I want to focus on, I mean, I'm sure that we talked a lot about the good examples of how the Arab revolutions and revolutionaries have used the internet successfully. I'm sure many of you are very familiar with how Twitter and Facebook and FriendFeed and others new media platforms were used very, very successfully. I think we haven't had enough focus on how the governments have been using the same exact tools that we're talking about. The governments use these tools. So new media is a space of liberation, and people did manage to organize and maybe get a spark for organization there. But I'll give some examples of how you know, the government as well have been using this space. I not believe that it's a level playing field. This is what I think the conventional wisdom is regarding new media, that there is no difference between us. I can start a Twitter account, and the government can start a Twitter account. So what's the difference? I think, I mean, speaking about Twitter, the difference is that, for example, I captured these streams last year. When you write in Twitter, when you write United Nations General Assembly or the word Palestine, the first thing that comes up is a promoted tweet by the Israeli Prime Minister. I can't do that. I can't promote my tweet on Twitter. We can't, actually. I mean, it's not that we don't have money, but Twitter does not allow individuals to promote their tweets. I mean, advertising, I think, is a very, you know, clear example of how it's not a level playing field. And I'll give you actually an example that just happened yesterday by complete coincidence. One of my friends started a campaign in Iraq because the Iraqi government is planning to build an oil pipeline that goes through the historic city of Babylon. It's not a joke. They actually are building an oil pipeline through a city that is thousands of years old. So my friend started a campaign. I helped him in starting the Facebook page. It was just like 2 days ago. And so I volunteered to spend $100 from my own money on promoting something. No one does that in Iraq. No one has credit card. I have a credit card, and I live in Washington, D.C. So I spent $100, and you just, because there is no bidding, so the click is so cheap. It's for 2 or 3 cents to get the click. So for $100, I managed to get 2,000 people to click on the ad. And now the campaign has, you know, almost 2,000 likes on it. So this is me, you know, helping a friend on an environmental project with $100. Imagine what governments can do, especially in places like Iraq. In Iraq, these YouTube, your Facebook pages always have advertisements. And unlike Twitter, you can't tell who is paying for it. Now, when people see the ad that I put, stop building the oil pipeline, they don't know that I paid for it. It doesn't show who paid for it. So there's no transparency there. Anyway, my point is that it's not a level playing field. It's the issue of advertisement. I'm sure that, you know, it affects things a lot. The other issue is the issue of surveillance. Governments, very efficiently, have been you know, catching activists online. We can't catch the government online, you know, we can't find their IP addresses. They're not using our provider, we're using theirs. You see, that's the problem, that they can find people's IP addresses, they break into their homes. In Syria, for example, the sophistication of the surveillance was really shocking. They even managed to get fake certificates. I mean, for the geeks, and the audience, this allowed them to stage a man in the middle of the attack, you know, where the government actually, you can't tell that the government is watching, because all of the information goes through their certificate. Very sophisticated, very expensive types of attacks. We can't stage these things. And the third thing which I will talk about now, actually, is an example that just happened last week in Jordan. Very, very dangerous. Government infiltration of new media. I call it phishing. Phishing with a PH. It's when the government States new media and acts as an activist. This is extremely dangerous because you can't tell who is who. You know, like when the Egyptian revolution was going on, the last couple of days of the revolution, there were so many rumors on Facebook, even on the main websites. Like, I'm sure all of you guys have heard of Kulina Khalid Saeed page, which has almost 2 million people now. It was just completely attacked with fake information about people going back home, the revolution has ended. You know, people don't really know what's going on, and there is no revolution headquarters that you can call and that's why. So that's the strength of when governments do phishing attacks. The one that I wanted to mention just happened 2 days ago. I was following it and I took some snapshots of it. In Jordan. Jordan has, there was a demonstration going there for it's like the first anniversary for one of the social movements in Jordan that is asking for reform. What happened is that the Jordanian activists wanted to go to one central square, and just 2 hours before the arrangement, there were very strong rumors that the meeting has been cancelled. So I traced it actually, it goes back to this website. I'm just to show you how efficient the government is. If you search for the fake announcements, it shows on around 20 different government websites and Facebook pages. And of course, other people start picking it up. So what they did is that they infiltrated, they got the password of one of the Facebook pages that actually is legitimate. And they post the wrong announcement on it, and then everyone copies it from there. So that's extremely, you know, dangerous, and governments have been getting better at doing it. The other example that happened in Egypt in the last days of the revolution, there was an attack on Al Jazeera, and what the attackers did from inside the Egyptian government is that they posted, you know, this black part here. They posted a slogan saying, "Let's work together to bring Egypt down," making it as if Al Jazeera is against Egypt, not against the Egyptian regime. I actually blogged about it at that time. So what they did is that, this is a snapshot of the website when it happened, this is the attack, the image here. What they did is that this was an advertisement, this was the upper image, the original one. It's an advertisement for MSF, you know, an NGO to give donations. So they attacked that and they put this picture saying, "Let's bring Egypt down." And then they spread the pictures from here. I actually traced it back to the same person who has a Twitter account and a Facebook account. Traced it back to this, where this person takes a snapshot. Of course, after that they deleted their account, you know, they don't exist anymore. But they took a snapshot of the page after they had infiltrated it, and they said, "Oh, see how we told you the Al Jazeera is anti-Egypt." Extremely organized and sophisticated, very subtle. You know, they don't go to Al Jazeera and say down to Al Jazeera. You know, they go there and they put a message against Egypt. They spread it to attack Al Jazeera's accountability. You know, like, these are very sophisticated intelligence agencies that are working on things that we are working on. Let me try to wrap up. The bottom line.